Praise the Lord, saints. My name is Evangelist Deborah Tate, and I'm with Royal Diadem Ministry, and we are an internet ministry. Last night, I talked a lot about Goshen. I told you that Goshen was a part of Egypt, and at the time the Hebrews lived in Egypt, they had became oppressed by the new Egyptian ruler who had forgotten all the good things and the kind deeds and how God had used Joseph to help him or help them as a country during a famine. I also mentioned last night that or yesterday night that the 11 brothers, and the number 11 always means confusion. The 11 brothers of Joseph who were responsible for throwing him in a pit and selling him into slavery did not realize that they had sold seeds of slavery into their family line. I mentioned before we went off the air that you always have to be careful what you sow, because what you sow, you will reap. And sometimes not just you reap, but those that are closest to you will reap it. Those that you love the most will suffer. And then you'll find out that that generational curse because of sin will trickle down to the second, third, and fourth generation. But there is hope. And the hope is in the blood of Jesus. Also mention how the Egyptians were struck down dead when the death angel came. Anything that wasn't covered up underneath the blood. And if we notice, the blood of the lamb was placed on the lintels of the door of a house. If you've followed me on any of my teachings on Blog Talk Radio or on Live365.com, I especially in June when I talked about Father's Day, I mentioned that one of the definitions of the word house is family. A family or a generation of people that came from the same father or had the same bloodline or genetic background or had the father who is the progenitor. When we study about can you really have a family without the father in the midst? I mentioned that another name for a family is a household. And God promises us household salvation. So when one of us is covered with the blood of the Lamb, we're interceding for our family members, we can rest assured that God is working in their lives to bring them out of that Egyptian bondage and to bring them over across the Red Sea along with us and to take them into Canaan. Now, that's an encouraging word. We can guarantee that God is working, because God wants to see our loved ones saved more than we want to see them saved, because he created them and he knows better what hell is like than what we like. Okay, then what we know is what I should say. It's then better than what we know hell is like. Okay, so he wants to save our loved ones. So if you got one person in your family that's praying, you're a blessed person, because the prayers and the cleanness of that one person in that family can maybe save a generation, can save a household. And the Bible shows us this in so many different ways. The Bible also shows us that God not only makes provisions for us for salvation, but he even makes provisions for those that don't even believe in God. And he's so merciful that he even gives them time to come to a saving knowledge of who he is, whose bloodline is not even the bloodline of the Israelites. Because if you look through the Bible, even when they came out of bondage, the Bible talks about the mixed multitude. The Bible talks about the mixed multitude. Those were people that were Egyptians that left Egypt with the Israelites. So we see that even from the foundation of the world, God has been in the business of saving people. He's been in the business of salvation. He's been in the business of restoration, of healing. Not just one group of people, but the whole world. The Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth on him would not perish, but have eternal life. God wants us not to perish. He wants us to have eternal life. Why is Israel called God's chosen people? Because he chose them to be a representative of him, to show nations who he is. Just like God has chosen you and me to be saved and filled with his precious Holy Ghost so that we can show nations who he is. So we can preach the gospel of Jesus Christ to nations. This is why God saved you, and this is why God saved me. He saved us so that he could use us to save others. I have a portion and a quota that I have to meet, and you have a quota that you have to meet. We all have people that we have to bring to a saving knowledge of who Jesus Christ is. We all have that quota. We all are important. We all have a work. We all have a ministry. So the Bible tells us that this new ruler was oppressing the children of Israel. He was oppressing them psychologically. He was oppressing them mentally. He was oppressing them emotionally. He was burdening them down economically. He was dominant. He was controlling. He was subjugating. And he was trying to put them down by force because he was fearful of them. The Bible, as you know, the devil is fearful of you. He's fearful of the God that is in you because he knows that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Satan knows that if you submit unto God, that you'll be able to resist the devil and that the devil will have to flee. Because it is the cleanness of your hands and your obedient walk and your obeying the voice of the Lord that gives you power. And that's the only way you'll get power with God, is through obedience. The Bible even lets us know that Jesus Christ was obedient all the way to the cross. And we will have many crosses that we will have to bear before we leave up out of this world. But we know we can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens us. We know we can make it because greater is he that's in us than he that is in the world. The Bible tells us, Jesus said, these things I spoke of unto you, that in me you might have peace. He said, in the world ye shall have tribulations, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. So we know that Jesus has overcome the world. We know that the name of Jesus overcomes the world. We know that Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. And this is what Moses and Pharaoh, the mixed multitude, and the Israelites are about ready to find out. The Bible tells us, we spoke about this last night, that Pharaoh, who was fearful of the growth, the development of the Israelite children, he felt threatened by them. He felt that they would go against his enemies and side up with his enemies against him. And he was right, because his enemy is God. God is the only enemy he has. Why? Because the Pharaohs thought they were gods. They thought they were looked upon by their own people as human deities. But we know that those that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. In spirit and in truth. We know that man can never be God. Man cannot create, because man is a created being. Satan cannot create. Satan is a created being. And he can only do as much as God will allow him to do. And he must seek God's permission before he can do anything. He too is subject under God. Now that's an encouraging word. We know that Moses' mother made a basket of papyrus and pitched and put baby Moses in the Nile River not knowing that it would be water again that would bring the people of Israel into salvation, into deliverance, into the promised land. They would have to cross the water. And it's the same thing with us. The Bible tells us to be ye baptized in the name of Jesus for the remission of sin, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost that was promised unto you and unto your children. Household salvation, the family. Now that's an encouraging word. We left off last night. I had a little problems. I had a little tickle in my throat, but it's okay. I'm fine today. We talked about how Miriam kept her eye on her little baby brother. I told you that if you wanted to read more about Moses, you could find that in Exodus chapter 2, verse 4 as a baby. And if you go to Numbers chapter 26, verse 59, you'll learn more about the genealogy of Moses. The Bible shows us and shares with us that it was Pharaoh's daughter who found Moses in the water in the basket of papyrus and pitch. And she sees that this is a good looking child, and she decides to raise the child up as her own. But she knows she has to nurse this child, and she doesn't have milk in her breasts. So she sees Marion, and Marion says, I know somebody that can feed and nurture and nurse this baby. And she goes, gets her mother, who is Moses' mother, and she gets a chance to bond with her son. And how she probably was speaking the word of God over his life. She probably was telling him about El Shaddai, because that's who they knew God to be, El Shaddai. But God was going to show them and demonstrate to them that he was Jehovah. They will learn God as Jehovah once they left Egyptian bondage, cross the Red Sea, go into the desert. They would know God as Jehovah. We learn that Moses had to flee for his life, because once he found out who he was, and the only way he could find out who he was he found out that he was a child of El Shaddai. He found out about the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But he took things in his own hands, and he made a big mistake and murdered a man and had to run and had to flee. But now he is on the backside of a mountain in a desert. And he's at this desert, and this desert, in the middle of a desert, is a roaring mountain that thunders and lightning and flashes. And he's there in solitude, in quietness, and he's listening to this mountain roar. I mentioned last night that a true prophet will be in isolation. Most prophets who are lawgivers, who point people in the direction of the Lord, spend a lot of time alone with God. If you see a person that is constantly around a lot of people, that's not a prophet, because prophets spend a lot of time in isolation, listening to the Lord, practicing listening prayer. I can't stress to you the importance of listening prayer. The Bible lets us know that Moses sees a burning bush. This bush is burning, but it's not consumed. So he inches up a little bit at a time to get a better look at the bush. What is this strange thing? Maybe it's not flames. Maybe it's something else. I need to get a closer look. And when he gets up close, he hears a thunderous voice. Moses, Moses. And Moses is struck strange. The bush is talking. And the bush tells him This is holy ground. Take off your shoes. Now I want you to turn your Bibles with me to Exodus chapter 3, verses 11 through 14. And of course, I'm coming out of the King James Version. And the word of God says this, and Moses said unto God, who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt? And he said, certainly, and this is God talking to Moses, I will be with thee, and this shall be a token unto thee that I have sent thee. When thou hast brought forth the people out of Egypt, ye shall serve God upon this mountain. Some scholars say that the name El Shaddai means God of the mountains. Verse 13. And Moses said unto God, behold, when I come unto the children of Israel and shall say unto them, the God of your fathers has sent me unto you, they shall say to me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them? In other words, they're going to say, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice? Verse 14. And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, thus shall I say unto the children of Israel, I am has sent me unto you. Exodus chapter 5, verses 1 through 2, coming out of the King James Version. And afterwards Moses and Aaron went in and told Pharaoh, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, let my people go, that they may hold a feast unto me in the wilderness. Now this is now Moses is talking to Pharaoh. And Pharaoh said, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice to let Israel go? I know not the Lord, neither will I let Israel go. When you don't obey the word of God, when the word of God tells you not to put substance in your body, and it says that ye are the temple of the Holy Ghost, and that God dwelleth in you, and that if any man defiles God's temple, in him God shall destroy. Which temple are ye? And you go in hand and you smoke and you drink. You are saying, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice? Neither will I let Israel go. When you mistreat your family members, mistreat those that are in the body of Christ, you are saying, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice to let Israel go? I know not the Lord, neither will I let Israel go. Actions speak louder than words. When we're not loving and kind, we're saying, who is the Lord that I shall obey his voice to let Israel go? I know not the Lord, neither will I let Israel go. Exodus chapter 6, verse 1 through 3. Then the Lord said unto Moses, now shalt thou see what I will do to Pharaoh, for with a strong hand shall he let them go, and with a strong hand shall he drive them out of his land. And God spake unto Moses and said unto him, I am the Lord, and I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, unto Jacob by the name of God Almighty, El Shaddai. But my name, Jehovah, was I not known to them. Who is the Lord that I should obey his voice? In my last teaching, I asked this question several times. Did we know what we were asking when we asked who God is? The world is asking who God is. They're trying to find who God is. They're using drugs, alcohol, false religions. They're doing everything they can to find out who God is, and they're not getting the message. They're not understanding, because the Bible, in order to understand the Bible, you have to spiritually discern. That means you have to be filled with the Holy Ghost. That means you have to be baptized in the name of Jesus for the remission of sin, meaning you have to go to a church and be completely immersed in water, symbolizing our death in Christ Jesus and our resurrection with him. Now that's an encouraging word. I mentioned that the word who is a pronoun. It's a possessive pronoun. It expresses ownership. God owns us because he paid the price for us. He bought us with his shedded blood. He bought us and took us away from Satan by dying on the cross. He owns us. We belong to him. He has legal rights to us. Now that's an encouraging word. We also say who God is through our behavior. If we are obedient to the word of God, then we can say we know who he is. We know his voice. But it's demonstrated more so through our lives. We know that actions speak louder than words. And we know that there is more to this walk than just God's grace. Oh yes, God gives us grace. He gives us grace so we can walk obedient to him. But if I'm not walking obedient to the Lord, then I do not know his grace. Because it is his grace that gives me the ability to walk obedient to him. How can you know the voice of the Lord if you cannot be holy? For he says, be ye holy, for I am holy. Now that's an encouraging word. Romans chapter 6 verse 15, coming out of the King James Version, says it like this. What then, shall we sin because we are not under the law but under grace? God forbid. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness? Who is the Lord that I should obey his voice? If you are really familiar with the story of how Israel came out of Egyptian bondage, then you know that Pharaoh had a very tragic ending. Not only did the Egyptian army was destroyed, but Pharaoh was destroyed too. He drowned with them in the Red Sea. But Pharaoh died, and you will die too, spiritually, for eternity. If you live a lifestyle that says, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice? Last week when I ended, or yesterday when I ended, I said I wanted to talk to you about the backside of the desert, and we will. However, I feel that you really need to know who Jehovah is, because God tells Moses this. He says, you know me as God Almighty. You know me as El Shaddai. You know me as the God of the mountain. But you don't know me as Jehovah. I'm getting ready to reveal to you another side of me. Don't you know that God has to reveal himself to you? You can't figure out God. Unless God tells you, unless God shows you who he is, you can't figure God out. You don't have the intellect, the capabilities to understand God. God must reveal himself to you when he chooses to. There's nothing you can do. There's no way you can take a class and learn 6 points on how to get God to move. God does what he wants to do when he wants to do it, because he is sovereign. He is God, and there is nobody else beside him. The word or the phrase God Almighty means El Shaddai. The word El means God. It also means, as I mentioned before, the God of the mountains. If you get a chance to listen to the beginning of this teaching, you can go to royaldiademministries.ning.com. If you were listening and reading along with me in Exodus chapter 3, verse 11 through 14, and coming out of the King James Version, at the beginning of the teaching, the word of God in Exodus chapter 3, Moses is asking God, who are you? Who should I tell the people you are? They're not going to believe me unless I can tell them who you are. In verse 11, I'm going to read it again for your hearing. And Moses said unto God, who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh, that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt? And the Lord answers him in verse 12 and says this. And he said, certainly I will be with thee, that I have sent thee. When thou hast brought forth the people out of Egypt, ye shall serve God upon this mountain. El Shaddai, the God of the mountain. One of the definitions, as I mentioned earlier, is Shaddai. Just Shaddai, not the El, just Shaddai. Was God of the mountains. El is God. And it is associated and is connected with the traditions which are inherent patterns of thought and actions of Abraham. Some conservative scholars say that the word Shaddai also means to overpower, to destroy. And we see that God does overpower and he does destroy Pharaoh, because Pharaoh is in direct defiance against the voice of the Lord. El means might. El means strength. El means power. El appears over 250 times in the Tanakh, which are Jewish scriptures that consist of three parts of sections of the Torah. You have the Torah, you have the prophets, and you have the writings. El Shaddai, or Shah, S-H-A-D, means breast in Hebrew. In Genesis chapter 17, verse 1, coming out of the King James Version, the Word of God says this: And when Abram was 90 years old and nine, the Lord appeared to Abram and said unto him, I am the Almighty God, El Shaddai. All significance, all sufficient, all powerful. That's who he is. Who is the Lord that you should obey his voice? He is El Shaddai. All sufficient, all significance, omnipresent, all powerful, mighty, marvelous, awesome God. In other words, God is saying that he can fulfill a need. He can fulfill a requirement. He is abundance. He is more than adequate. He is more than quantity. He is the supply. He is the source. Now that's an encouraging word. God wants you to know that you are a sinner and that you're in need of him. You need him. He is the source. He is the supply. He can meet all of your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. All you have to do is say, Lord Jesus, please come into my heart. And he will. He'll come into your heart. Now that's an encouraging word. My name is Evangelist Deborah Tate. I've been your host, and this has been 60 Minutes of Encouraging Words. We're going to go into a couple of musical interlude, and then we'll go back to our regular programming. See you later.